everyone, it's Anais from Dual Curiosity. Firstly, sorry for being gone for so long without much explanation. I don't really want to go into too many details and don't think I should need to go into them anyway, but a concise summary would basically be I was very burnt out after my PhD, I was quite stressed, this made me relapse with my OCD, and I felt like the best decision was to take a step back away from the internet and YouTube and try and reduce stresses in my life, get everything in order, and basically do what I needed to do to be less stressed. Now, sadly, I wouldn't say I'm totally better, and honestly, I'm still pretty stressed, but I am doing a lot better than I was, and I'm in a much better frame of mind to come back and make videos about science and curiosities and bugs and all the other things which I'm really enthusiastic about, and which I hope you'll enjoy too, so here I am. Secondly, there have been a few changes. I know you're all looking at the hair. It has indeed all gone. For me, this is quite old news now. It's been like this for a while and I really like it. However, I'm determined for the comment section to not be about my appearance. So if you do have any questions, I actually preemptively already made a few videos on my second channel explaining why I cut my hair. So please go watch those if you have any questions, because I've hopefully answered any question you could possibly have had about it. I do have a challenge for you though, and if you haven't done this already, because I have posted about it on Twitter and Instagram, but I would love for you to go to this link, bit.ly/braidweight, and guess how much you thought the braid that I cut off weighed. Please do weigh in with your best guess. I will be waiting. All that I ask is that you don't write your guess in the comments, because it might bias and influence other people's guesses, and we want to be as scientific as possible here. And anyway, if you felt that the meager 1 meter change in hair length was a big deal, wait till I tell you all about the 11,000 kilometer difference I've made to my life. A couple of months ago, I finally moved out of Oxford back to my hometown, Seville. And then about a month later, I moved continents to Malaysia. So now I'm living on the island of Borneo in the city of Kuching, capital of Sarawak State. I will probably also make a video on the second channel explaining why, but today's little story is set right here in this apartment in Kuching. So if you know me well, you'll know that I love my insects, and I will fully admit to the fact that one of the main things for which I was most excited about moving to Malaysia was the wildlife, specifically the insects. Tropical regions have a much higher biodiversity than temperate regions, and I'm here for it. Also, I really love the heat and apparently the humidity as well, so I haven't even used the aircon in this place yet. And instead, I usually just have my window open for ventilation, and also in the secret hopes that maybe some insect from the outside will make its way indoors for me to have a close look. I know it probably sounds like I have a death wish, but there are actually these really giant wasps, maybe hornets, I don't know, and they fly around outside, and I secretly really want one of them to grace me with a visit. I really want to see one of them up close. I know, you can call me nuts. Anyway, indeed, ask and you shall receive, and in my case, perhaps I received a little bit more than I bargained for. Now, I'm living in a high-ish rise building in the middle of a city, so it probably shouldn't surprise me that the vast majority of invertebrates that I've allowed to trespass on my premises, whether voluntarily or involuntarily, were not cool tropical bugs from the depth of the Bornean jungle, but household pests. And today's story is no different. In fact, I propose we play a little game. I'm curious to know how long it takes you to figure out what mysterious arthropods swarmed my flat, because as an entomologist, I'm personally ashamed by how long it took me to realize what these insects were. So let's set the scene. It's a weekday evening at the beginning of monsoon season, and the storms from the day had finally died down. I was working in my office, so like most days, I opened the window to allow a gentle breeze to come through whilst I sat at my keyboard. As the sun began to set, I noticed that a UFI, an unidentified flying insect, had made its way into my room. The first 2 seconds I saw it, I thought it could be a wasp as its body trailed behind it, but I noticed that it seemed to struggle a lot with flight, and hymenopterans are relatively skilled flyers. My next thought was this might be a neuropteran, because from what I could tell, it had roughly 4 equally sized wings that seemed quite large and membranous. However, this insect was also flying quite haphazardly, and whilst neuropterans might not be the most agile of flyers, they're generally quite graceful when they do fly. In fact, because it was flying with quite a nosedive and desperately spiraling into the ground, at first I thought it might have something wrong with its wing. And whilst this was happening, I noticed that another identical insect flew into my office. I had been graced with not one, but two, and then three, and four, and five, and by this point there were quite a few of them flying manically around my office. So I decided to quickly slink out into the kitchen, turning on a couple of lights along the way, because it was actually quite dark now that the sun had fully set, to quickly grab an empty bottle and a glass to see if I could contain these insects. By the time I got back to the office, which was only about 10 seconds later, there were over 10 of them in the room. So I quickly closed the window and put a glass on top of one of them to see if I could encourage it to stop flying and settle down so I could take a closer look. I tried to use my bottle with the other one and its wing fell off, which actually made me feel quite guilty. So I decided I needed to brainstorm a safer way to catch them. I did notice that one of them got stuck in a drop of water that had fallen out of the bottle. So I decided to fill the bottle with water and just pour it all over my tiled floor. Because they were flying intentionally into the ground and their wings were so big, the water actually did a very good job at just pinning them to the ground without drowning them. I briefly wondered if they were flying ants because honestly, this swarm reminded me of a nuptial flight, where many reproductive individuals all fly out at the same time on the same day in order to find a mate and found new colonies. So I did briefly think that they could be queen ants attempting to nest in the ground. However, when the mystery insects were trapped in the water, I could clearly tell that these were no Hymenopterans. They didn't have the narrow waist nor the elbowed antennae that are characteristic of queen ants. So I still didn't know what they were, and at this point I actually had to leave quite quickly because I was going to go to a dance class. So as I opened the office door to go and get changed, I was greeted by a swarm of around 300 of these insects that had gathered in my living room after I had carelessly turned the light on less than 10 minutes earlier. So what did I do? I very quickly refilled my water bottle and I just chucked it all over my floor. And surprisingly, in 30 seconds flat, every single one was glued to the floor. This was a surprisingly good method because the water creates a thin film on the floor, shallow enough such that the insect won't drown in the water, but because the insect's wings were so large, they're actually unable to unstick them from the water due to the surface tension. It is also reversible because if you remove the insect from the water and you allow it to dry, it will actually just be able to fly and live exactly as it did before ending up in the water. And to be honest, I expect no less of an insect living in a tropical rainy country. Additionally, also because it is so humid in Kuching, I believe it's actually the most humid city in Malaysia, the water shouldn't be evaporating anytime soon. So I was hoping it would keep them glued in place whilst I bought myself some time and went to enjoy my dance class and, you know, just delay dealing with them. So the whole area of the city seemed to be covered in these insects, as the stairway that led up to my dance class was also peppered with these mystery insects. On my way back 2.5 hours later, and still none the wiser as to what these non-Hymenopteran insects were, I remember I asked the guard at the apartment gates what they were. And he said something like Sembo or Semba. Not for lack of trying, I have not been able to find any word in Sarawak Malay or related dialects that matches with any type of flying insect and sounds like that. The closest I can think of is Sampa, which means rubbish, so I don't know what he was referring to, sadly. I saw quite a few of them on the ground and some were missing their wings and they were clearly being chased by their mates in a behaviour that's actually known as tandem run, where several males chase a female and the female chooses the one she wishes to mate with. So it was clear to me that this was definitely some sort of nuptial flight. Now, going up in the lift, I encountered two of my neighbours and I also asked them what these mysterious abundant insects were. They spoke in Chinese about it, but sadly my Chinese wasn't and still isn't good enough to pick out the name. But basically they said they didn't know the name in English, but they swarm occasionally in the early evening after there's heavy rain, and they smell really bad. I'm ashamed to say I actually verified that claim. When I finally opened the door home, Malaysia's humidity didn't let me down, and thankfully I wasn't received by another swarm, but instead by the insects still being mostly glued to the ground. However, some giant versions of these insects, almost like the boss of a video game, they suddenly materialized out of nowhere. But when they finally landed in my water trap, they seemed to almost purposefully shed or yank their wings off in order to continue being able to move. And the DL8 insect honestly looked very similar to a cockroach. And this is when the penny finally dropped for me. What insect has a life cycle very similar to that of ants in that they engage in nuptial flights in huge numbers and shed their wings soon before or after mating, and they seem to attempt to bury into the ground to found a new nest, but aren't Hymenopterans and are closely related to cockroaches? Termites! And termites are never good news. So we entered DEFCON 3, time to terminate the termites, say bye to the bye. Check out the chakaler,
ter muerte a las termitas,
shiruariwa mo shileru.
And the termites promptly went from reversible floor water quarantine to swift death by summer footwear compression and disposal via the sewage system. Anyway, admittedly, there is a very high chance now that some of the several hundred termites that invaded could have shed their wings, and for there to have been a pair of the opposite sex who used their strong, smelly termite pheromones to find each other somewhere in my flat and mate and found a colony. But so far, I have thankfully not found any evidence of termites, and neither have the termite experts that I paranoidly brought around. But I will keep you posted in a few months because, you know, it usually takes some time. I did keep some of the wings and corpses for identification purposes, and I'm quite convinced, although I'm also very prepared to be wrong and to be corrected. Termite experts, please do weigh in. But I think the small ones, sadly, do look like former sand termites or coptodermes, which is bad news because they are basically one of the most invasive and destructive species out there. The big ones might have been a separate species altogether because they were unusually large, maybe they were physogastric. I'm thinking maybe Macrothermes gilvus based on their size and coloration and wing shape, but who knows, maybe they were just mutant alates of those smaller termites, probably the Coptothermes. Anyway, there goes my story on how I'm adjusting to life halfway across the world and how my naive love of insects is definitely going to land me with some household pest infestation. I really hope you enjoyed this, and I would love to know if you guessed they were termites before I did. I'm still actually quite ashamed it took me that long, although in my defense, I've actually never seen an alate termite before. And honestly, I feel I've filled my lifetime quota of them, so I hope never to see one again. Anyway, I'll be posting regularly from now on, so it would be a great time to use the notification bell if you do enjoy my content and my ramblings. I would love to be posting weekly, but I do still currently do everything myself, so research, present, edit, design, animate the thumbnails, jump through all of the YouTube publishing hoops. So unless I make more videos that are a little bit more like this, which are a little bit more vloggy and require a little bit less post-production, honestly, it might still be 2 to 3 times a month. And also, I obviously still work on other things on the side, and one of the most recent things is I worked on the new Edge of Science series that the BBC and YouTube Originals are releasing on the 10th of December. And of course, I'm also determined to try and maintain a healthy work-life balance, which is the whole reason I stepped back in the first place. Anyway, I hope you're doing well, and as ever, thank you so much to my wonderful Patreons for supporting me, which also Patreon has now reopened after the hiatus. And as always, thank you so much for watching me, and I'll see you in the next one.